Einhard's Life of Charlemagne, written shortly after the emperor's death, records Charlemagne's burial in his palace chapel dedicated to Mary the Virgin at Aachen. Above his tomb, a gilded arch with an image and an inscription was erected. The inscription stated, "Under this tomb lies the body of Charles, the great and Orthodox emperor, who gloriously increased the kingdom of the Franks and reigned with great success for 47 years. He died in his 70s in the 7th indiction on the 28th of January in the year of our Lord, 814. The crucial designation of Charlemagne as Orthodox and that he died in the year 814 of the Christian era are clear statements that this is a memorial to a Christian emperor. Yet the resonance with the Roman past is most obvious with the provision of the inscription itself, recognizing both his imperial title and his achievements. In this, the Franks followed the custom of the Roman Senate's erection of monuments to celebrate their emperors. Although Charlemagne's inscription has not survived, except in Einhard's text, his supposed sarcophagus that you see here was a reused 3rd century Roman monument of Carrara marble depicting the rape of Proserpina. It is still on display to modern visitors in the museum attached to the palace chapel in Aachen. It's a clue that he was a very large man. If it is indeed his, it's a very, very large sarcophagus. The depiction of the story of the Roman goddess Proserpina's descent to the underworld and the association of her cult with death, life, and renewal was a common subject for sarcophagi in late antiquity. It is evoked in the late 4th century Latin poet Claudian's poem, written under the patronage of the Christian emperor Honorius, known as De Raptu Proserpine. Claudian, by the late 8th century, was assumed to have been a Christian, and his poem was one of those mentioned in the famous late 8th century syllabus of rare classical and late antique texts in the Berlin manuscript here on the screen. The list was once suggested as of some books in Charlemagne's library. And the arrow points to where the De Raptu Proserpine is listed. This list should be understood as a teaching collection, conveying something of Roman history, mythology, and culture, and representing a wide range of prose and verse styles. The list survives in a compilation of grammatical texts by scholars linked to the Carolingian court, and is possibly to be associated with the court of Charlemagne's young son, Pippin of Italy. The Christian elements in the Franks' own representation of the emperor's role, expressed both in Charlemagne's funerary inscription and in the apparent choice of a Roman tomb for the emperor's body, the knowledge in the Carolingian period of the late antique poem telling the story depicted on Charlemagne's tomb, the ability of Carolingian and Christian layman Einhard to write highly accomplished classical Latin in the early 9th century, and the additional corroborative context provided by this list of texts in the Berlin manuscript associated with the Carolingian royal court, all expose some of the many layers to the Franks' dialogue with the Roman past in the Carolingian period. Together, they prompt questions concerning the memory and authority of Rome and of Roman texts, both secular and religious, in early medieval Europe, and the special place of the Roman past in the memory of Europe as a whole. Let me first summarize the manuscript evidence for the transmission of Roman classical texts in the Carolingian period, and so put this Berlin list of Latin texts into a wider context. The particular contributions made by Carolingian scribes to the survival and transmission of classical texts has been acknowledged since Ampère first coined the term Carolingian Renaissance in the early 19th century. The statistics are indeed remarkable. Only a handful of authors or texts survive in late antique copies or fragments and emerge again later in the Middle Ages, such as Cicero's De Republica, Fronto, and the other texts listed here, and the Cicero is the underneath text in large rustic capitals with another text imposed on top. A few more texts survive in both late antique and Carolingian copies, namely the corpus of grammatic or surveying texts known as the Agrimensores, and here you have a 9th century example and a late antique example, late antique on the right, 9th century on the left. A few of Cicero's speeches also, Aulus Gellius, Juvenal, Livy, Persius, parts of the elder Pliny, the letters of the younger Pliny, and Virgil. And here you see a fragment of Virgil, and the larger on the left is a very, very much read, annotated copy made in the 9th century of Virgil. A substantial number of authors and texts have as their earliest witness post-Carolingian manuscripts, and here your handout will be useful for you, though some have recorded 9th century copies now lost or have been surmised to have been copied from Carolingian exemplars. And I've listed those on the front page of your handout, simply so that you can take it away and have it for reference. The earliest copy, though, of by far the greater majority of the classical Latin texts now known to us, however, is Carolingian, and this is List B, the earliest surviving copies of classical authors from the Carolingian period. Of these, some can be associated, there is a text of Cicero, with the Carolingian court itself, such also as the Lucretius Oblongus, associated with the palace school of Charlemagne, or this copy of Vitruvius, others such as Seneca and Q. Serenus Liber Medicinalis. Other works have been closely associated with particular Carolingian scholars, such as Alcuin of Tours and his successors, and Hadoardus of Corbie's famous classical Florilegium survives in a Vatican manuscript, and he appears to have presided over the copying of many classical texts at the monastery of Corbie. Henrik of Auxerre's compilation in the second half of the 9th century, also in the Vatican, included a number of rare classical texts. But it's important that this manuscript of Henrik also contains an epitome of Augustine on music and 4 anonymous sermons, and that the London copy of Cicero's De Oratore, which you see on the screen here, was written by Lupus of Ferrier himself, a man who also compiled a law book, wrote many letters, theological treatises, and hagiography. Many of these manuscripts have been exhaustively discussed in the context of the transmission of their texts and their place in that text stemma. Since Birger Munk Olsen's work on the production of the classics in the 11th and 12th centuries, moreover, it is usually understood that medieval copies of classical works cannot be regarded as a discrete category as far as their paleography or codicology is concerned. It may be possible to identify classical texts copied from late antique exemplars by their unusually large and more or less square format. And that's a characteristic not necessarily confined, however, to secular classical texts. Generally speaking, the presentation of a classical text in a 9th century manuscript does not differ from that of the presentation of any patristic or contemporary text. Comparison of library copies of Augustine, for example, the patristic writer, with the classical writer Lucretius, or, still more spectacularly, the beginning of Luke's Gospel in an 8th century Gospel book, here the Ab Vie Gospels from Charlemagne's court school, in comparison with an early 9th century Tours Cicero, now in Florence, shows scribes and artists responding in a similar fashion to the opportunities for the decoration of particular initials, and here it's, of course, the Q. Because so many classical or late antique texts survive in their earliest copy from the 8th and 9th centuries, such as this copy of the Caesar's Gallic Wars, now in Amsterdam, it is difficult to reconstruct the appearance and layout of late antique books and the changes Carolingian scribes may have introduced. Carolingian book layout was undoubtedly expert and often, as you see from this example, magnificent. But it is worth commenting on the scripts and letter forms that you see here as well. Older Roman bookhands and monumental scripts such as square capitals and rustic capitals, uncial script found in early Christian books in late antiquity, were used in the 9th century as display scripts. Caroline minuscule in the right-hand column was then used for the main text, and there's a close-up of Caroline minuscule so that you can see it. Caroline book script for texts evolved from the Roman script system. And here is an example of a full text written in that hand. Impressive and significant though it is, the production of classical manuscripts in the Carolingian period needs to be set alongside the creation of every other kind of copy of the works of authors of the early Christian era, early Frankish Gaul, Lombard Italy, Visigothic Spain, and Anglo-Saxon England and Ireland, as well as the writing of the plethora of new texts composed by Carolingian authors in the late 8th and the 9th centuries. This process involved not only the adoption and promotion of written culture for administrative, legal, religious, and educational purposes, and the universal use of Latin, but also the transmission into new contexts of secular, scientific, and early Christian texts and knowledge from the classical, late antique, and early medieval Greek and Roman traditions. Study of the role of such cultural models in the early Middle Ages, in both the barbarian successor states of Western Europe and North Africa, and throughout the Frankish realm created by Charlemagne, enables us to see how the knowledge of the past and of earlier texts could be appropriated. In the Carolingian period in particular, there is ample evidence of active intellectual engagement and the innovative presentation of knowledge to accommodate new needs and new institutions. Textual, social, and visual memory all played their parts. The manuscript evidence is crucial in this respect. The Dutch scholar Marie Kentuven has rightly noted, with reference to the classical texts at least, that the emphasis of past scholarship has been more on which classical authors and texts were read and copied, and when and where this happened. Her own focus has been on how they might have been read, and she's studied texts like that heavily annotated Virgil, and how they were copied alongside Christian texts. But here, I am more interested in why classical texts might have been read and copied alongside Christian texts, and what this may reveal about the status and authority of Rome. I should like to suggest here that the classical text should not be relegated to serve work in the schoolroom and the esoteric interests of a few exceptional scholars like Alcuin, Hadoardus of Corbi, Lupus of Ferrières, or Hairic of Auxerre, they were of course that as well, but need to be thoroughly integrated into any understanding of Carolingian culture. The key I suggest and wish to explore further now is the essentially Roman origin of all these Latin texts. How can the part Rome played in the cultural memory of the Franks and the context in which it developed be investigated? How and why was the authority of Rome communicated and established in the various contexts of politics, ideology, law, the organization of knowledge, language, and religious orthodoxy in Carolingian Europe? Charlemagne's conscious emulation of the careers of past Roman emperors provides an obvious evocation of the authority of Rome. Charlemagne's titles used in royal charters, his portrait coins after his imperial coronation in Rome in 800, and the sole surviving example of one of his lead seals used in legal documents, for instance, conveys similar messages to that of the funerary inscription you saw earlier. So the charter states that he was emperor of the Romans, crowned by God, king of the Franks and the Lombards, and his portrait coins depict him as a Roman emperor wearing a laurel wreath with the inscription Imp Erator Aug Ustus. And his seal, unfortunately, I have no picture, signals the renewal of the Roman Empire, Renovatio Romani Imperii. Members of Charlemagne's court also developed the Roman imperial theme and the strong association between antique Rome and the realm of the Franks. Most obviously, Einhard's account of Charlemagne's career and achievements, written soon after his death, probably therefore between 814 and 817, and effectively presented as funerary panegyric, was itself a literary representation of the ruler, influenced by specifically Roman portraits of political leaders and emperors. One of Einhard's principal inspirations was Suetonius, the classical author, famous, if nothing more, for the lurid account of Nero. Another was Tacitus's Agricola. And the third, an extraordinary 4th century concoction known as the Historia Augusta, which is again serial biography. And there's an absolutely lovely Renaissance copy up in the Mirror of the World's exhibition upstairs. The text of Suetonius was known to have been at Fulda in Germany in the earlier 9th century. That's where Einhard was at school, although the earliest surviving manuscript was written at Tours, circa 820, which is this one. And similarly, the other copies of Historia Augusta, Tacitus, were also known there. Another literary artifact to commemorate the relationship between the rulers of Franks and of Rome, that is, the Carolingian king and the pope, was composed circa 800. The epic poem Carolus Magnus et Leo Papa, sometimes known as the Paderborn Epic, has been described as a refashioning of the Aeneid. It invokes ancient geography in describing Charlemagne as the father and pharos, beacon or lighthouse of Europe, and describes Charlemagne as lord of a city where second Rome flourishes anew, whether or not it is actually referring to Aachen or to Paderborn. So my abilities are unequal to Charles, a king most just in his deeds, head of the world, love and paragon of his people, venerable hero of Europe, excellent father, hero, emperor, and lord too of the city, where a second Rome flowers anew, its mighty mass rising up into the great heights, the lofty cupolas on its walls touching the sky. The account of the construction of the palace and church in this poem is particularly Virgilian in character, and the new city itself is embellished with such Roman elements as theatre, forum, great wall, towers, and baths, but only, alas, in the poem, not in reality. Further, the eclogue of the Frankish court poem Modoin invokes an image of Charlemagne's new palace, presumably at Aachen, as the rebirth and restoration of Rome and the new Rome of the Franks at the palace, characterized as caput orbis. My Palamon looks out from the lofty citadel of the new Rome and sees all the kingdoms forged into an empire through his victories. Our ties are transformed into the civilization of antiquity. Golden Rome is reborn and restored anew to the world. These poetic comparisons made by Carolingian poets are reflected physically in the large palace complexes with public spaces, rich materials, and expert workmanship in emulation of Roman imperial styles built at Aachen, Compiègne, Frankfurt, Ingelheim, Nijmegen, Paderborn, Regensburg, Worms, and many more within the Frankish Empire. These included spaces for ceremonial display. Aachen, for example, incorporated an aula, residential buildings, and the palace chapel. And at Ingelheim, there was a 90-meter-wide semicircular building with aula regia and wide frontal towers in Roman style. This has been reconstructed from the archaeological evidence. The palaces were built and decorated with deliberate evocations of the imperial past, not least with spolia from Roman buildings. According to the poetic description by Ermold the Black in about 826, the royal aula at Ingelheim reinforced the imperial associations of the building complex with a series of ruler portraits. Ermold's description of the decorations of the palace claims that the walls, in a comprehensive evocation of historical models, were painted with representations of Ninus of the Assyrians, Phalaris of Sicily, and Cyrus of the Persians, Alexander of Macedon, Hannibal of Carthage, and Romulus and Remus. The choice of subjects for these ruler portraits opens up a further dimension of the memory of Rome in the Carolingian world, with the significant juxtaposition thereafter of the Carolingian mayors and early kings on these walls as well, Charles Martel, Pippin III, and Charlemagne, with the Roman emperors Augustus, Constantine, and Theodosius. The point of this choice is clearly emphasized by Ermold. The Franks and their wondrous deeds continue the acts of the Caesars. But despite Ermold's evocation of the Romulean name of the Franks elsewhere in the poem, I was the first of the Franks to take the name of Caesar, and I gave this Romulean name to the Franks to keep, the Roman models described by Ermold move from Augustus to the emphatically Christian emperors Theodosius and Constantine, whose images from the famous colossal statues and Missorium, respectively, you've just seen. The German art historian Lammers suggested that all these rulers were a visual representation of the historical concept within the 5th century writer Orosius's 7 books of history against the pagans. I should like to suggest here, however, first of all, that a further, albeit not necessary, alternative inspiration for both Ermold's poem and the paintings it describes was the Universal Chronicle of Eusebius Jerome, written in the 4th century. Secondly, this chronicle needs to be acknowledged for its formative influence on the Carolingian understanding of Roman history and the way in which it shaped understanding of Christian Roman history. It is significant that a sumptuous copy of this remarkable text was produced for, or at least associated with, the court circle of Charlemagne. It is still extant in the manuscript known as Leiden Scaliger 14, which you see here. Because of its influential framing of Roman history and arguably of attitudes to Rome, let me say a little more, therefore, about this chronicle. It's a late antique history book, copied in the Carolingian period and throughout the Middle Ages. There are also 2 5th century Italian copies of this text extant, the fragments of one of which is in Leiden, now that you see here, and you can see how fragmentary it is, written in Italy in the 5th century, and the other, a full text, is in Oxford. The Universal Chronicle of Eusebius Jerome, first composed by Eusebius in Greek and covering the years from Abraham to 324, was translated into Latin by the patristic writer Jerome, also responsible for the Vulgate Latin Bible. The Greek version no longer survives. Jerome extended the entries to 378 and made many additions of his own throughout Eusebius's texts. And some of these have been deduced from a very early Armenian translation made from the Greek. The Chronicon does not take the form of continuous narrative, as you can see here, about the succession of empires, but is presented in columns, recording different chronological sequences, such as the years since the birth of Abraham, Olympiads, and the regnal years of kings, judges, and so on. The chronicle is then constructed in columns spread at first over 2 pages or an opening, and later on with 1 page, and short historical notes. Sometimes the columns are color-coded, with different columns written in red, green, brown, and black, as you see from this Oxford example. Entries are also differentiated by use of a hierarchy of script types and script size. So columns are devoted to the rise and fall of the empires of the Assyrians, Medes, Persians, Athenians, Romans, Macedonians, Hebrews, Egyptians, and others, 19 in all. Some of these you can see in the 9th century copy made from the earlier Leiden copy. And the columns also created curious chronological juxtapositions by putting all your empires in sequence across a page. So Saul coincides with Homer, and King David coincides with the Amazons. The demise of a line of kings or of an empire is quite simply signaled by the removal of a column. Gradually, with the advance of Rome and the conquest of Egypt, the columns steadily decrease, until only 2 remain, it's a bit like painting an atlas pink in the old days of the British Empire, here it's columns, until only 2 remain, that of the Romans and the Jews. So you have a visual map, the historical portions gradually increase in width. And after the destruction of Jerusalem by Titus in 71 AD, the Romans alone remain. The historical notes record events quite briefly, such as the career of Moses and Alexander the Great, the founding of Rome, the victories of Cyrus, the fall of Troy, the birth of Christ, the destruction of Jerusalem, and so on. In Eusebius' version, the shape of the past was indisputably determined by the Old Testament, but the adjustments Jerome made in relation to the history of the Latins and Rome actually subtly and steadily Christianized the history of Rome. Jerome's juxtaposition of Roman and Jewish history forms a backdrop for the emergence of Christian protagonists in the history of Rome. In other words, Jerome's version of the Chronicon is determined by his perception of the history of Rome. The chronological chart and juxtaposition are, of course, the work of Eusebius, and Rome's rise to prominence with new cities and colonies and the succession of consuls and emperors meticulously noted was part of the original scheme. If one focuses on the additions Jerome made, however, then a very different picture emerges, all of which contribute to a distinctive, if schematic, history of Rome, in which Jerome is able to incorporate Christianity even more than Eusebius had done. Jerome's additions can be summarized briefly as follows. First of all, he consolidated the intellectual inheritance of Rome by recording the names and flourishing dates of the famous writers, Varro, Virgil, Livy, and others, as a brief counterpart to another text that he had written. Secondly, Jerome noted the political rulers of Rome and events within the city, such as the fates of the Vestal Virgins and the burning and destruction of particular buildings. Thirdly, he recorded the succession of the bishops of Rome, those that we call popes now, which of course are part of some of the succession of bishops once recorded by Eusebius. Jerome added notes about the long ancestry of particular families and institutions, such as the gens Iulia, founded by Julius, who had migrated with Romulus to Rome. And he provided notes on legends associated with Rome's topographical landmarks, such as Aventinus, about the same time as Elijah the prophet, the elder son of Romulus, who was buried on that hill, which is now part of the city and gave that place its permanent name. So the Aventine Hill. Other short formative episodes in the structuring of Rome's political system are indicated. Coinciding with the period of the Babylonian captivity of the Jews and the careers of Esther and Mordecai, Jerome recorded the first holding of the Centennial Games and how the Romans, through ambassadors, sought one out laws from the Athenians from which the 12 tables were inscribed. He noted that the Decemviri were created 302 years from the founding of the city and the creation of the tribuneship of the plebs and aediles. Further, Appius Claudius Caecus laid out the Appian Way in BC 364. Topographical landmarks are noted, such as the burial of Augustus in the Campus Martius. A link between the emperors and the emergence of Christianity is provided in a passing observation about Nero, who, in addition to all his other crimes and extravagant activities, was the first to carry out a persecution against the Christians in which Peter and Paul gloriously died at Rome. The history of the Roman Empire in Eusebius Jerome's Chronicon thus actually presents itself predominantly as a history of the city of Rome. And from the birth of Christ, it becomes an account of the Christianization of the city and of the empire. The succession of popes thereafter provides the chronological framework, interspersed with events in Rome and imperial actions. Jerome's original translation of Eusebius' Chronicle, therefore, reoriented the themes of Eusebius' original text in order to highlight aspects of Rome's past in the context of universal history from the creation and the formation of a Christian Roman identity. It is this which the text communicated to its Frankish readers. This was hugely influential for Frankish understanding of the Roman past. In a further and equally influential transformation of the Roman past and communication of a particular memory of Rome to a Frankish audience, the Liber Pontificalis, or Book of the Popes, authors, first in the 6th century and then those who continued the original core text into the late 8th and 9th centuries in the context of the history of Rome, presented the popes as the successors of St. Peter, Prince of the Apostles and leaders from Rome of the entire Christian Church. The transmission of the papal history of Rome is strikingly Frankish in its concentration. It's one of the peculiarities of the way this text has survived. Many of the earliest extant manuscripts, such as the late 8th century manuscript you see here, which is now in Leiden, were produced in Francia in the 8th and early 9th centuries. Distinctively Frankish versions of the 8th century Lives in particular were created. Unfortunately, there is no precise evidence that would enable a court association with the Frankish recensions to be established, even if a court knowledge of the text can reasonably be supposed. The most crucial aspect of the Liber Pontificalis in its later 8th century biographies, however, is the integration of the Franks into Roman and papal history. Literally, they are written into it. And the way in which Rome's past is made a relevant aspect of Frankish historical memory. One example is the additions made to Life 94 of Stephen II in the Frankish recension, such as the account of Pope Stephen II's visit to Francia to crown Charlemagne's father, King Pippin, and the transformation of the mausoleum of the Emperor Honorius, this is this building here, into the chapel of St. Petronilla, who was a new saint discovered in a cemetery in Rome in the 8th century, and because of a faulty inscription, interpreted as the daughter of St. Peter. According to the Liber Pontificalis, in its B and D, that is the Frankish recensions, Stephen had promised King Pippin that it was there that he would place Petronilla's body, and it's still Petronilla, a very, very important saint for the French ecclesiastical calendar. Similarly, Life 97 of Pope Hadrian describes the visit Charlemagne made to Rome at Easter in 774, and like Theodoric the Ostrogoth 300 years before him, Christianizing the Roman imperial adventus, or arrival into a city, by praying at the confessio of Peter the Apostle in the Basilica of St. Peter's before he entered Rome. The association with the Pope culminates, of course, in the coronation of Charlemagne as emperor by Pope Leo III. And this picture shows the remains of Pope Leo's dining room still on a traffic island in front of St. John Lateran. These Christian or Christianizing representations of Rome's past become part of the Frankish memory of Rome. That memory, of course, also incorporated the knowledge of the literary and historical understanding of Rome received from the classical and late antique texts of Virgil, Suetonius, Livy, Tacitus, Velleius Paterculus, Lucan, or Tropius, with which I started this lecture, all of which were available in the Frankish world. A further range of texts and associations with Rome, moreover, is suggested by the function of Aachen's Palace Chapel. Although ornamented with new and recycled antique marble columns, mosaics, elaborate bronze screens, and monumental bronze doors, it was dedicated to Mary the Virgin and became the center for the promotion of the Roman Christian liturgy. The particular association between the Roman liturgy, the papacy, and the court of Charlemagne is manifest in many extant manuscripts produced by the so-called court school of scribes and artists, both for use in the palace chapel and for dissemination to other centres within the kingdom. Godescalchs and Evangelistri here is perhaps the most sumptuous of all. It's written in purple dyed vellum, and some of you may know how expensive purple was, and it's written in gold and silver. And it was commissioned from Godescalch by Charlemagne and his wife Hildegard in the 14th year of the Frankish king's reign, associated with Charlemagne's second visit to Rome and the baptism and renaming of his eldest son Carloman as Pippin, later King Pippin of Italy, in 781. We know this because there's a very helpful little inscription, as you see here. The book is a lectionary of the so-called Frankish Roman type, which offers 208 gospel readings for all the major feasts of the temporal and sanctoral cycles of the liturgical year. The book includes votive masses for particular occasions, as well as masses for the dead. The calendar with the calends and ides, according to the Roman system, lists a host of Roman martyrs. We have here Marcellinus, for instance, Prisca, Agnes, And there are then some Frankish saints and other Italian saints. The first of the Gospel readings is the Christmas reading from St. Matthew's Gospel, that is, the genealogy of Christ, arranged opposite a portrayal of a baptistry or fountain of life, possibly reflecting the Lateran baptistry itself. The Codex as a whole is a statement of the king's faith and his obligations. It is a statement of his alignment with Rome. Not only was his son baptized by the Pope in Rome itself, but the book incorporates Roman liturgical time and the Roman liturgical framework of the Gospel readings as a very precise indication of the king's determination to associate himself with Rome in this way. The book itself is essentially commemorative in its immediate function, produced to mark both a particular occasion and to commemorate the new association with Rome on the Frankish king's part. The associations prompted by the Godescalc lectionary do not stop there, for the dedication poem depicts Charlemagne crossing the Alps to Rome with the special goal of bringing gifts to St. Peter. And here you can see, highlighted in red, the words of Romulean city. Further, the anonymous lament on the death of Charlemagne, written soon after 814, laments the death of Charlemagne, mourned by Rome and Francia alike, and buried in the earth of Aachen. But it also stresses the unequivocally Christian element of Charlemagne's relationship with Rome. And this is a planctus and set to music and sung, as you see here from the early notation. O Christ, receive into your holy dwelling among your apostles the pious Charlemagne, alas for me in my misery. And so the poem proceeds. The effect, and if you want to know what it sounds like, go onto YouTube and look up on the death of Charlemagne. The effect of this reiteration of the connection with Rome in the observance of the Roman liturgical calendar overall, but especially the anniversary feasts of so many Roman saints, the readings during Mass from the Roman lectionary, in the celebration of Mass on the basis of Mass books specifically designated as Roman, such as this sacramentary here, in their compilation of Roman ordines, which are the rituals and stage directions essentially for conducting the liturgy, and in the referral to many canons and papal decretals, also disseminated from Rome, is that the sacred memory of Rome extended into Francia and was revered and commemorated. The entire perception of time based on the commemoration of Christian Rome was absorbed into Frankish political and cultural life. The Frank's special responsibility for Roman saints was further articulated in a redaction made of the Salic Law, where the Franks are represented as rescuing the relics of the Roman martyrs, revering them and decorating them with gold and precious stones. We should not underestimate the ideological force of the presence of these Roman saints in the Frankish realm. Every primary text I've mentioned so far in this lecture and every manuscript I have shown you is written in Latin, and is a representative instance of the strength of Latin culture and learning, and of the Roman cultural inheritance within the Carolingian Empire, actively promoted by Charlemagne. From the 780s, the Carolingian kings and the lay and clerical scholars they gathered at court and supported in major concentrations of education and learning throughout the kingdom contributed steadily to the consolidation of Latin in education, learning, religious worship, government, and law. They thereby secured access to the knowledge and texts of classical antiquity in the early Christian era. This promotion of Latin learning and culture was more than a zeal for education and intellectual activity. The underlying aim can be summarized by the word correctio, in which the emphasis on correct language, correct texts, proper conduct, rigorous ecclesiastical discipline, religious reform, artistic creation, and intellectual endeavor were all to be combined in service to the Christian faith. Time and again, moreover, in their response to the 8th century dispute over icons in Byzantium, refuting the adoptionist heresy emanating from northern Spain, proposing a theological emendation of filioque to the creed so that it became the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son, affirming their loyalty to Rome in claiming their liturgical practice to be Roman, fostering devotion to Roman saints, and encouraging the observance of the papally approved collection of canon law, the Franks had demonstrated their orthodoxy and loyal conformity with Roman practice. This common Latin culture, grounded in the works of classical antiquity, the Latin Bible, Latin writing of the Church Fathers, the early medieval writers from Italy, Spain, Gaul, North Africa and the British Isles, Latin translations of Greek texts from the East, and the host of authors from the Carolingian period was expanded as Frankish rule and Christianity extended ever further east and north. The formation of a tradition of writing and learning in Charlemagne's circle of scholars, as well as in his own letters, capitularies, and charters, was thus anchored in the Roman, Frankish, and Christian past. And I'm simply showing you a few examples of some of the texts I've been talking about, the dispute about icons, the capitularies, and so forth. But the most obvious evidence for the conservation and promotion of Latin as a body is a body of evidence on which I've only recently begun to focus, namely the remarkable number of Latin glossaries or dictionaries extant from the 9th century. In such numbers, my list is over 200 already, as to suggest copies in most of the intellectual centres of the Frankish kingdom. The words in all these glossaries, with synonyms attached and sometimes fuller definitions, mirror the choices and understanding from 800 years of the Latin language. They represent the most basic means of securing an inheritance and are the most potent carriers of cultural memory. Every word has its original context. Every word and all the meanings associated with it was identified as potentially pertinent to new contexts. There are even dictionaries of Tyronean notes, which is very curious. It's a form of shorthand used by Carolingian notaries in law courts. These dictionaries complement, moreover, the interest in Latin grammar and Latin spelling also represented in so many extant Carolingian manuscripts and newly composed texts. Let me now sum up and leave you with some wider considerations. The Christian religion and the association with Rome on many different levels also transmitted a complex understanding of the Roman past, the alignment with a particular intellectual tradition that explicitly based itself on an expectation of continuity with the Roman past, as well as their own earlier Frankish past, and the practical underpinning of a distinctive sacred topography and cosmology. Contemporary Frankish history was placed by its authors in the context of the history of Rome and of the Franks in the Merovingian period, even back to their origins in Troy. Frankish universal history, plus Carolingian knowledge of biblical history, and the rise and fall of empires charted in the Chronicon of Eusebius Jerome, reflects the Franks' perception of both a new age and continuity of human history. The Franks are clearly presented as successors to the Romans, but with their own special place in a past that stretched back to the creation of the world. At the end of the Vita Caroli, Life of Charlemagne, Einhard reported that Charlemagne had left instructions for the distribution of 3 inscribed silver tables and 1 made of gold. One of these was a round table depicting Rome, the second, square in shape, depicted Constantinople, and on the third tabletop, the whole world was depicted within 3 concentric circles. What we know of early medieval depictions of the world, such as the one you see here, suggest that Rome and Constantinople would have figured prominently on any map of this kind. The 2 late 8th century world maps that survive in manuscripts here now in the Vatican, a diagram to show you a little bit more That up there is Sri Lanka. And then the Albi manuscript, which is much more difficult to work out what's on it, have very little information on them, but Rome is nevertheless a prominent feature in both maps. Similarly, Rome is singled out for special treatment on the Peutinger map, though here it is conceivable that extra embellishments were added by the later copyists. Such maps and references to them have an obvious practical value in that they represent attempts to depict knowledge about the physical world in diagrammatic form, and thereby give us an indication of early medieval perceptions of the world and of the city of Rome. But the image of the city of Rome on tables that belong to Charlemagne also has a clear symbolic resonance. Einhard's association of Charlemagne with these tabular depictions of the imperial cities of old and new Rome, as well as of the whole world, function as an enhancement of his imperial power and the effort he made to control the geographical extent of his empire. Knowledge, learning, and religious devotion were an integral component of the Carolingian king's political interests and conception of their rule. In this world created of texts and reality, Rome and its history, that is, the place of Rome in the memory of contemporary Franks, is all important. But this same memory has many facets. They combine to underpin the tradition of text and practice emanating from Rome. The Roman liturgy assumed a crucial place in the cultural memory of the Franks, but so too did the Christian history of Rome and the special memory of Rome as a holy as well as an imperial city. What I referred to at the beginning of my lecture as the Franks' dialogue with the Roman past consequently manifests itself in many forms, textual and material, intellectual and actual, spiritual and devotional, historical and political. Above all, the text to which the manuscript evidence bear witness all serve to communicate and establish the importance of Rome, Roman history, and of the integration of Christian and imperial Rome into the cultural memory of early medieval Europe in the various contexts of politics, ideology, law, the organization of knowledge, language, and religious orthodoxy in early medieval Europe. Finally, the manuscript evidence I have discussed in this lecture is the outcome of three crucial factors which still operate in any formation of any library now: human choice, social and intellectual communication across time and space, and the human contributions to both the survival and destruction of evidence. It may be helpful to invoke the notion of entanglement as a framework to understand quite what that entails, for we cannot think of the manuscript books or the printed books in this library or even their contents as the sole points of any inquiry. In the field of quantum mechanics, entanglement expresses the degree of interaction on the part of any one particle that could not be fully described without considering those with which it interacted. Nothing within a system can be regarded as fully independent. The social sciences use entanglement as a convenient portmanteau word to express the complex network of interdependence of many human activities and the material objects created in the process, or what the archaeologist Ian Hodder has termed behavioral chains of interaction. Historians, book historians, paleographers, librarians, therefore, mostly deal with the final products of a host of interactions: the physical activity of agricultural production, animal husbandry, mining, smelting, stone quarrying, for the raw materials of parchment, pens, inks, pigments, as well as commercial markets and supply routes for these commodities. Then there is the creation of the material artifacts necessary for the production of books and documents that implies workshops, craftsmen and women, apprentices, and distribution networks. Further, there are the skills of the scribes and later, of course, of the printers themselves and their social and institutional relationships and the accommodation of their training and work within society, at the heart of which is the linguistic, literary, intellectual, and religious education they needed to acquire. in order to write what was required for the new individual and institutional contexts in which the readers and users of the texts were based. The Latin language, promoted in diverse ways by every single one of the texts considered this evening, was one essential vehicle for the continuing authority of the Roman past. I have suggested that while that past was essentially Christianized, the understanding of the place of the Roman classical inheritance was also never lost. Perhaps I can give the last word to the Frankish scholar Lucas de Ferrier, who offered the young King Charles the Bald in 844, the grandson of Charlemagne, a number of reflections on the necessity for the king to rule with justice. He adds a number of moral directives culled from the Psalms, Proverbs, and Book of Wisdom. He ends his letter by suggesting that Charles should, I quote, "Be pleased to consider, in respect to your advantage and ours, the use of advisors such as the Romans, masters of the world, employed." Thank you very much.